So you want to get certified, do you? Great. So did I, and I just did. And I'm going to share what I learned. These are my tips and tricks and tactics and hacks and whatever buzzword that you want to use for passing the bubble certification exam. So if you don't know anything about bubble's developer certification, in short, if you're a developer, you're going to do an exam that's made up of basically multi-choice questions, single choice questions, or fill in the blank questions that encompasses or is attempting to encompass the whole bubble experience, right? The different features that you have in bubble, how you would go about tackling different types of problems, scenarios that you will encounter when building bubble applications, and how kind of things will behave under certain conditions, right? How certain elements or certain data will behave under certain conditions. So it's attempting to test you on if you know your stuff when it comes to bubble. Now, just before we get into things, should you even care about this exam? And yes, you should. You definitely should care about this exam because clients, agencies, people are going to hire you. Some of them are going to care about this exam. Now, I've got another video where I talk about some of the pitfalls of the exam in terms of actually proving that somebody knows what they're doing as a bubble developer, but it still does matter to some extent. It matters because the people who don't know bubble at all are going to be filtered out from the list of credentialed bubblers, right? So you're only going to be left with people who know bubble at least somewhat, which is still valuable. So the exam is definitely valuable, if nothing else, for that fact. But also, if you're credentialed and you've got an agency account, then you're going to get access to bubble RFPs, which are basically where clients who hear about bubble come to bubble with a project looking for a developer. They're going to write out their project description, and then it's going to be distributed or be allocated to certified bubble accounts. To be in that list of certified bubble accounts, you have to have the certification. Now, super high level just to start, right? This is my rough ratio of the types of questions that you'll get in the exam. 25% scenario-based questions, thought experiments, okay? You have an app, an e-commerce app. It's got these data types. It's got this many users, right? Here's the scenario. Here's the problem. How do you solve it? Okay, those kind of questions. Another 25%. It's again, the scenario-based questions. You've got an element with these responsive settings, okay? How does it behave at different page widths, right? You've got a dynamic expression that is X, right? What's the output, okay? It's stuff that you can test yourself to find the answer. And then the other 50%, the remaining 50%, I would say, are reference-based questions that you can use the bubble manual to find the answers, right? This is an open book exam, so you can do that. So before you start the exam, how do you prepare? The first and most obvious one is to just get enough experience under your belt. You can always try the exam, fail, and try again. Bubble will let you do one failed attempt. So that first attempt you can use to calibrate whether you're ready or not if you're a little bit unsure. And if you're completely fresh to bubble, like I wouldn't be rushing straight into getting the certification. I would be trying to build applications. I'd be trying to do a course or some videos if you can. This channel's pretty good for that. But more importantly, just get into the weeds of building apps with bubble. Like just try, take an idea that you might have or an application that's out there in the world and try to recreate it, right? You're going to make mistakes. You're not going to do it the right way, but you have to do it the wrong way first before you can really understand not only how to do it the right way, but why the right way is the right way. Beyond that, if you think you've got enough experience, okay, then to prepare, these are the things that I would do. Have an editor open with a bubble app that you can go and play around in. And you want to make sure that this editor has access to the paid features, okay? So you may want to have just one sandbox app that you're just playing around in. I mean, you definitely want to have a sandbox app that you're playing around in. You might not necessarily want to upgrade that app to a paid plan just to get access to the paid features. So if you've got another application that maybe you're using in production or it's on a paid plan, I would have that one open too, okay? Because you want to be able to test both of those features. And sometimes there's things that are restricted on the free plan. And the idea here is that when you get questions, especially that second category of thing that I mentioned, which is like under these conditions within the bubble editor, like how do things behave, okay? With those questions, you want to just get into the editor and just set up the scenario as it's mentioned in the question and then just see for yourself. So this, have the editor open, have the manual open, right? The bubble manual is going to be one of the major places that you're going here to get answers. So you want to have that open in a tab as well. Bubble do say in the preparation for the exam that you shouldn't really have more than 3 tabs open. I did at times have between 3 to 6 tabs open And I didn't get any kind of automatic warnings or anything, but definitely try whenever you can to keep those tabs to a minimum. Now, super important stuff, make sure that you've got a big glass of water or whatever your beverage of choice may be, and go to the bathroom before you start. This is an exam just like you used to do at school or college. It's 3.5 hours. You don't have to use all of that time. I'm gonna have a little sip, but of course, you want to make use of the time to make sure that you're not just skipping through things. Now, also keep in mind, choose a day and time where you're not likely to be interrupted, right? You can't have anybody coming into the room while you're doing it, because there's this proctoring software that is automatically detecting if you're cheating, okay? And one of the things that's gonna be flagged on is if somebody else comes into the room or walks behind you, okay? So you want to make sure that you're in an isolated environment, quiet environment where you're not going to be interrupted for 3.5 hours. Make sure you go to the bathroom first as well. Although they do allow you to get up to go to a bathroom break. But I think if you do it too many times, the automated system might flag your attempt for review. Tactically speaking, as you're going through the exam, what things should you keep in mind? We've just been talking about time. Let's stay on that topic. Time management, as with any exam, is very important. What I did and what I think would work well for most people is to do a first pass through the entire exam without getting hung up really on any one question. So go through, don't spend more than 5 minutes on any one question and add your answer in. Do that, go right through to the end of the exam. And as you're going through, some of the questions you're just gonna add in, you're gonna go, that's obviously right. That's 100% right. There's no way that can be wrong. There's gonna be a lot of questions where you're like, ooh, it could be this if they mean the question to be like this, or it could mean X if they're interpreting the question like this. And you want to mark those questions down as you're going through, just so that when you're going through and do a second pass, which I'm going to get to in a minute, you just know what questions to look out for. Okay, so get to the end of the exam. What I did that took me about 2 hours to get through to the end of the exam. And then I went all the way back to the beginning and started going through again. Now, in the current exam portal, there is no way to just go, take me back to question one, or take me back to question 40, okay? You have to hit that previous button 90 times, all the way back to question number one, but now you can go through in order again and check your answers as you go. So especially in that second pass, pay attention to the questions where you were a little bit unsure, right? And here's where you can dig in a little bit more, spend a little bit more time thinking, right? You know that if the clock ends, you at least have an answer for each question. Okay, so the time pressure's off, which is the whole point about doing a first pass and then going through and doing a second. And so you can use that time to your advantage to really interrogate things or to set up a more rigorous test environment and application and test things out. Now, one thing just to keep in mind is that I found that some of the questions were ambiguous, where I was like, do they mean the question like this, or do they mean the question like this? And I marked them down in a category of their own. It was basically a category of, I'm going to be pissed if this question is wrong because of X, Y, and Z, right? Because it's so easy to misinterpret the question. Or even I thought, that answer might be factually incorrect, like based on my experience, okay? Problem is, Bubble doesn't tell you what questions you got wrong. So I think I got 8 questions wrong out of 90. And going through that whole exam, there were no questions where I was like, I'm completely unsure. I don't mean that to like talk myself up. I've been in the game for a little while, right? But I spent my time being careful and thoughtful about every question. So I was actually surprised to get that many wrong. And I think it came down to the questions where it was potentially a little bit ambiguous. Unfortunately, Bubble doesn't tell you, at least not when I did it, what questions you got wrong. So this is just something to be mindful of. You've got to give an answer for those questions. I can't really tell you, of course, which way to go, but just something to keep in mind. It's not always going to be super clear cut, and you're just going to have to pick an answer. The other thing, obviously, just get really good at going through the Bubble manual. If you don't use the Bubble manual much, which you should, then do that. Just, I guess, get a little bit of a feel for how it's laid out. Some of the articles are nested, especially recently, Peter Amelie, who's one of the big players in the Bubble landscape. He's gone through and he has updated a whole bunch of that Bubble manual, and the quality now is much better than it used to be. And there's a lot of categorization into, you've got like short form technical reference articles, and you've got like kind of longer form articles. So just try to get a feel for how the relationship is between those, make sure that you're looking at the right place, but they're usually hyperlinked. So you don't want to be just getting lost, just like endlessly going through the bubble menu, right? Like you want to be searching for things, trying to get to the right place as quickly as you can. Now, when you finish the exam, you get told straight away whether you passed or failed. If you pass, congratulations, you are now one of the elite 300 people at this moment, which is an incredibly, to me, surprisingly low number. And if you failed, you're going to get another chance to do it unless it's your second attempt, and then you're going to have to, I think you have to wait a little bit of time, I'm not sure, but you can buy another set of attempts, essentially. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. Look, the exam is a little bit of a chore, right? There's no beating around the bush, but just be intentional about it, right? Be well rested, set out a good scope of time, be prepared. Don't try to cut corners here and just try to get it done super quickly. Be your best self when you're going through this exam. If you know bubble well, you're going to be absolutely fine. If you're a little bit unsure, you still might be fine as well, but just make sure that you go into it with the right mindset. All I can say is good luck and happy bubbling.